Hello again, everybody, and have a good day of grace of God now. And let's have a look for Psalm 34. Psalm 34, please take if you have some application or Bible or something you can read and follow this sermon. All right. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him, and were lightened, and their faces were not the same. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles. All right. Again, we are dealing with the psalm that touches more on the personal life of the believer than the doctrinal themes of the Advent and the Tribulation. I will bless the Lord at all times. Two men practiced this. One man was in the Old Testament and the other was in the New Testament. These two men were Job and Paul. Paul manages to do it longer than Job, but Paul has the advantage of a completed salvation, 39 books written by God, plus a revelation of New Jerusalem. My soul, her boast. Note that is in Romans chapter 4, verse chapter 7, verse 4. The soul is spoken of as feminine. In the first three verses, there are five mandates given to a Christian, with a Christian, in regards to the Lord. We are to, one, magnify him, that is, enlarge his glory and increase his size in the sight of the heathen. Two, praise him, that is, worship him verbally with our mouths. Three, bless him, that is, make him happy by our conduct. Four, boast of him, that is, brag about what he does. Five, exalt him, that is, raise him up as high as we can, even higher than all. In this psalm, verse 3, is the greatest marriage proposal that any young man could give to a Christian young lady. The promises, of course, are in Hosea chapter 3, but this is the proposal: O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. What a great blessing it would be if you can, with someone and with some people, magnify the Lord, and you can together, let us exalt his name together. Amen. Verse 17 shows that verse 6 has a primary application to salvation under the law. The blind man said, we know that God heareth not sinners. John chapter 9, verse 31, and he is correct within the context of the Old Testament law. The angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him, and delivered them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. O fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. The guardian angel idea comes from this, although the children's guardian angel of Matthew chapter 18, verse 10, is in the third heaven, not beside the child on earth. The mention of the angels in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 10, suggests that angels might still be present. The angel of the Lord referred in the passage is the Lord Jesus Christ, according to Paul, Acts chapter 27, verse 23, and Galatians chapter 4, verse 14, or Jehovah, according to Dr. Luke, Acts chapter 7, verse 30. The encampment, verse 7, suggests the presence of more than one angel. See, for example, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 17, and Jacob's host, Genesis chapter 32, verse 2. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Compare this with 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 3. It will also go with Isaiah chapter 55, verse 1 to 3, with C. The reference is not to the Baalite cannibal sacrifice of the mass with its drink offering of blood. See Psalm chapter 16, verse 4. But to a living God, whose cup of salvation, Psalm 116, verse 13, was never connected with Rome, neither directly or indirectly. It was Roman soldiers who whipped him and crucified him, and it was Rome who beheaded James and Paul and threw Peter in prison. Come, ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desireth life, and loveth many days, that he may see good? Keep thy tongue from evil, and thy lips from speaking guile. Depart from evil, and do good. Seek peace, and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are upon unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth, and delivereth them out of all their troubles. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. This section is a teaching. The psalmist says in verse 11 that he is about to teach you the fear of the Lord. What follows is the conduct of a man. If that man really does fear the Lord, the expression itself, the fear of the Lord, is defined in four places. They are Job chapter 28, verse 28, Psalm chapter 111, verse 10, Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13, and Proverbs chapter 15, verse 33, Psalm chapter 19, verse 9, and Proverbs chapter 10, verse 27. Talk about what this fear produces. And Proverbs chapter 14, verses 26-27, likens it to a fountain and a strong confidence. Well, the fear of the Lord is for people who love many days and desire to see good. Verse 12, the following things must be practiced. First, keep your tongue from evil. Verse 13. Second, don't speak guile. Verse 13. Third, depart from evil and do good, verse 14. Fourth, seek peace. Fifth, go after it till you get it, verse 14. It's not for nothing that Paul has to admonish the body of Christ to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. The eyes of the Lord, the ears of the Lord, and the face of the Lord are tuned or aimed in a certain direction. They are upon the righteous, verse 15. They are upon to his cry, verse 15, and they are against them that do evil. Note the work element completely missing from the Pauline epistles. No Christian is going to be cut off from the earth, verse 16, just for doing evil. Alexander the coppersmith did evil, and he outlived Paul. Likewise, Demas went back into the world and outlived Paul. The man who went to bed with his stepmother, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, was restored. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 5 to 8, and Peter, James, and John certainly were not delivered out of all their troubles, verse 17. Neither was Stephen. Salvation in the New Testament is not conditioned on a contrite spirit, verse 18, but it's conditioned upon receiving a risen Savior, Romans chapter 10, verse 9. And John chapter 1, verse 12. We can spiritualize everything and make devotional applications, but doctrinally we are on the Old Testament grounds. Verse 17 will take place literally for the Christian at the rapture. And one can say that Paul was delivered out of all his troubles, like the psalmist says in verse 19. But this was when he was executed. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 18. Still, it's true that the Lord is nigh to those of a broken heart and contrite spirit. See Psalm chapter 51, verse 17. Humility is the thing, brokenness. It's when the alabaster box is broken. Mark chapter 14, verse 3. It's when the bread is broken. Mark chapter 6, verse 41. It's when the pitchers are broken. Judges chapter 7, verse 20. Then the ointment is detected, the multitudes are fed, and the light shines through. It's Christ's body which is broken, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, for us that makes salvation possible. Not a bone of him was broken, John 19, verse 20, but his flesh was broken in more than one place. To cut off the remembrance of them from the earth, verse 16, the remembrance of the world's great men, and they are there many. The broken heart in the passage has been broken because of sin, and the contrite spirit has been brought down into the dust because of the way of guilt, see Psalm 51. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivered him out of them all. He keepeth all his bones, not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and they that hate the righteous shall be desolate. The Lord redeemed the soul of his servants, and none of them that trust in him shall be desolate. The righteous this time is the Lord Jesus Christ, verse 20. But even he is not delivered until after he is tortured and killed. Again the theme of the first set of Psalms shows up, verse 22, then that trust in him. One can prophetically apply the word redeemed to Romans chapter 3, verse 24, and Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. Those that hate Christ will be desolate, verse 21, and the same thing is said under another figure in Proverbs chapter 1, verses 27 to 33, where Christ is figured as wisdom. See Proverbs 8. Those that trust in him will not be desolate, verse 22. The corrupt Alexandrian Septuagint erases the messianic reference by converting the he of verse 20 to there. And this one you can see in many Bibles, if you compare also. At least some Bibles this mistake has made, like many others, according to Septuagint, which is claimed to be translation before born of Christ, but it's after the born of Christ, somewhere 200 after the born of Christ, this Septuagint has exist. And this Septuagint has done pretty much damaged the Bibles and Bible translations, and of course it's not the only one which has made damage, but I would say that it's not so reliable than it's claimed to be. Anyway, something you can trust and believe and trust. You have something visible you can trust is the pure words of God, King James Bible 16:11. That's the one you can trust. Don't trust Septuagint or Septuagint-based text, or Westcott Hort-based text, or minority text, so-called minority text, or Leningrad manuscripts, and so on. There are many kind of translations and Nestle Aland work and so on, but they are not so trusted. They're missing a lot in those Bible which they are based on. But I could say if you can trust something, it's Old King James Bible 16:11 in English language, the most spoken language in the world. And also similar kind of translations you can find in some other languages. And the one you should trust right now, not tomorrow, not later, because you can't surely know what will come after. But something so important to believe right now and trust right now. And it's of course, as you can know, the Lord Jesus Christ, the true God and true Savior, who shed his precious blood on the cross of Golgotha because of your sins also. You, your sins, your walk on earth and so on, if they are just like that, without that, you cannot be redeemed, you cannot be washed in the blood of Jesus Christ or anything else, it would be for every people here so much sin that I think the destruction would come immediately. There wouldn't be any grace. But now we are living in the dispensation of the grace of God time. This time is the dispensation of the grace of God. And we have a grace of God, and for by grace are ye saved by faith. It's not of yourself, it's not from works. That's the one which believe and trust now. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Amen.